Gathering of half a million hippies on the Isle of Wight in the summer of 1970 marked the first festival of the 70s as well as the last of the 60s. The dominant music that weekend was rock, now relentlessly loud, denim-clad, and an almost totally metal affair. Rock was the music of the 60s underground, but by 1970, bands were making big money and commercial forces were moving in.
First of all, you have the counterculture that starts to play urban blues. It starts to sing dirty words, sing about sex, drugs, things that really happen, and tries to get down. And then gradually you have the pop machine thinking, we've got to co-opt this.
Unlike Woodstock, the Isle of Wight was not a free festival, which incensed those hippies who still believed that the music belonged to everybody.
The artists need to be paid in cash or they will not perform. If you do not have a ticket, then you must leave the arena. You may sit on the hill.
But in between heavy sets, the DJs kept playing a three-minute song whose curiously catchy sound enraptured the audience.
He was so beautiful, really beautiful, and his songs were just, ah, they were girls' lyrics, weren't they? Ride a white swan. I mean, it's like, what guy would say ride a white swan? I mean, it's so limp-wristed. It's beautiful.
I remember seeing Bolan after all these heavy bands had been on stage, and he came on stage and he said, "Hi, my name's Mark, you might have seen me on Top of the Pops," you know, and all the blokes in the audience were picking up clods of earth and chucking them at him, and all their girlfriends were going, "No, he's lovely, leave him alone."
It was Ride a White Swan by Mark Bolan, who the audience had known up until then as a winsome acoustic folky.
It was pretty much bongos, acoustic guitar, and a voice. Eventually he had a Ride a White Swan, they put drums on it, and he saw the evolution that there was actually a gap. It was kind of similar to when Bob Dylan went electric. Cut it down, made it more raw, brought that sound together and moved forward.
Things began to take off for the electrified T-Rex with their first appearance on Top of the Pops. Having already persuaded him to wear some unusually colourful clothes for the occasion, his publicist had a last-minute idea that would launch Bolan's pop career.
Just as he was going on stage, on Top of the Pops, live, after having done the rehearsal already, she got a whole lot of glitter and just threw it into his face. And that was really what made his image for the next 3 years.
Since the death of the Beatles, there'd been a vacuum in pop, and newly dandified Mark Bolan answered the prayers of teenage girls the country over.
The girls went crazy over Mark. He was adorable. He was one of the most beautiful men I've ever met in my life. And I remember Ringo Starr said to me, as a Beatle, "I've never seen anything like this." He says, "Those girls are crazy." And they were. They wanted to rip him to pieces.
Get It On heralded the moment when glam rock was invented. mixing up sexually suggestive lyrics with childish rhymes, colorful clothes with a thrusting rock guitar. Mark Bolan made girls scream again and opened the doors to a world that would eventually belong to one of his pals from the 60s fringes. But first, he too would have to undergo his own transformation.
Just look through your window. Look who sits outside.
In fact, David Bowie wasn't even sure he wanted to be a pop star at all. Flirting with the theatre, he studied mime and dance with theatrical guru Lindsay Kemp, and the pair enjoyed a close relationship.
We shared many of the same passions, particularly for vaudeville, variety, the musical, David playing his 12-string guitar and singing these wonderful, haunting songs. He began doing dance classes with me. I certainly gave him an awareness for movement and a lot of the tricks that goes with transforming oneself.
And I'm floating in the most peculiar way.
I listened and I fell in love. I fell in love with the voice and with the lyrics, with the contents of those wonderful songs. I'm still a little bit in love with David.
Leaving Lindsay, he released Space Oddity, which reached number 5 in 1969. But the transformation that would propel him to the big time was not yet complete. Like Mark Bolan before him, it would take a woman's touch to ignite his career.
I wanted everything shiny and everyone beautiful, and I wanted them to jump out, so they popped. I just thought, wouldn't that be better than people in jeans? And it took a little persuasion, but I'm very persuasive if I'm motivated, you know, and I was motivated. I loved him so much. I thought this would be so cool if we could just do something different and exciting.
Angie introduced David to the dress that he wore on the front cover of The Man Who Sold the World. The cover went down well in a country by now used to Mark Bolan's glittering forays into the charts, but it was deemed too risque for America, who hadn't yet got the glam bug. David was very willing to be transformed, but the rest of his band were a little coy.
He just made people realize that looking good doesn't make you a puff. With those boys, that was a problem. Oh, I'm not gonna wear that. I'll look like a bloody puff. No, you won't. Great, you got this great torso. What do you think they take pictures of those boys that are surfing? Oh, I don't know about that, Angie. I could get a shock. I might electrocute my... Now, that's a good thing to be worried about.
Eventually, even Yorkshire lad Mick Ronson relaxed enough to enjoy himself.
I mean, it's hard to shock anybody nowadays, but in those days, that was still a shocking image, you know. The overtone of him, like, fellating Mick Ronson's guitar. That got a lot of people at it. And of course, getting people at it was part of the design. It wasn't all just for art and aesthetics. It was also, you know, there was quite a lot of that going on.
Mark and David, who were doing the glam rock thing to its fullest, weren't really afraid of what people thought of them. And although it took courage to do that, it takes courage to wear, for a man to wear makeup and to put on these clothes and to be right out front and in your face. It really takes courage. But I think as a British phenomenon, it had favor already. Everyone went to pantomime and saw men dressed as women, you know. And so it wasn't like that really unusual, that strange. Only the context was new. It was like now it was rock.
By 1972, Bowie had joined Bolan at the top of the glam rock world. Pop music was back for the first time since the Beatles' heyday, and three-minute pop songs dominated the charts. Between them, they would foster a sound and look that was both innocent and subversive.
When I first saw Bolan and Bowie, they looked like they could have come from Mars, really. But would be possible for you to turn yourself into it. Plus, it was always a way that working class tough nuts could be all right with their feminine side.
First heard about Bolan, I was at school in Leeds, and just let me know that there was something else going on out there. You weren't sure even what it was. You couldn't even give it a name. It was just something, the way he wore glitter on his face, the way he was kind of effeminate. It was hard to believe that now, but it was very shocking at its time. And it created a divide in the school playground. Usually me and the girls that like T-Rex, and all the lads that kind of like posturing rock.
While Mark Bolan had been preening himself, rock was undergoing a transformation. It had become heavier and louder, and teenage boys could not get enough of it.
Transistor radios were the only things you had to listen to music on that were portable, and the only access you had to new music was the radio. That was it, no internet, nothing like that. And every now and again, stuff would happen on the radio which just sounded like electric. It would be like, wow, what's that? And heavy electric guitar, blues bass riff coming out of a transistor radio just sounded monster. It sounded great.
A monster riff could also mean monster business, bigger than anything Bolan and Bowie could achieve.
Thank you very much. I'd like to introduce Led Zeppelin to you.
Led Zeppelin were Britain's biggest rock export. They laid the foundations for stadium rock worldwide.
On bass guitar, John Paul Jones. John Paul Jones.
Mainly, you view it as being able to play to more people. And you get nicer dressing rooms. And eventually, you know, I mean, we started touring by car, which is utter hell, to tour by bus, which is medium hell in those days, to touring by jet, which is heaven. It became an event. That was the big thing. Zeppelin were coming to town. So you went, because to be anywhere else would be somehow to be missing out.
For touring British rock bands, America became the boys' ultimate playground, the birthplace of many of the enduring myths of sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And Led Zeppelin were the archetypal hellraisers. There were stories of black magic, pacts with the devil, wrecked hotel rooms, and orgies. Plenty of them. I'm gonna
give you my love. There were a lot of orgies going on. There were a lot of people playing around and trying to see what worked for them sexually and what they could get away with and how far they could go. A lot of my friends did a lot of that. And there was also a lot of guys having sex with guys. They weren't gay or anything, and same with women. There was a lot of that going on. And Zeppelin sort of came along right at that time and, you know, took full advantage of all that. And they realized they could get away with a lot of stuff, so they did.
When they came to America, they were hot shit, and they knew it, and it went to their heads before they hit the shores. And they were not very nice, just a lot of us. They had this routine that they were basically humiliating a lot of us groupie girls. John Bonham was the main instigator. He was like a mad dog. He would like, you know, he would drink or whatever it was he was doing, and his eyes would kind of like roll around his head. I remember one time when he dragged me out by the swimming pool, the Chateau Marmont, and he threw me into the pool wearing all my best pan velvet antique clothing.
All those things that went on and were part of people trying to work out where they stood in terms of their sexuality, because you had gone in an incredibly short space of time from the very, very repressive era of the 50s into the 60s, the sudden arrival of the pill, the sudden arrival of this wild music, drugs, throwing off everything that your parents' generation had been. And actually, people were also very confused. I mean, that's something we certainly knew about women, because we were confused. Like, what were you meant to do? Were you meant to kind of follow your heart? Were you meant to follow your body? Was there a right thing to do? But out of that, of course, came lots of the stories about groupies.
The groupie, like at that time, was not a negative thing. It was a very people wanted to be groupies, and the women were doing what they wanted to do. So I would have my birth control pills, for instance. I always carried them around with me, and I felt like I was a feminist. You know, that was a big word back then, being a feminist, and I'm sure groupies were looked upon, you know, with disdain by actual feminists in their pants and everything.
How long have you known her then?
Oh, I'm actually, Jimmy knows.
You understood, as a musician's old lady, that they were going to do this thing. And what my old man used to say to me was, I didn't kiss her. I didn't kiss her. And I'd say, what makes you think that I'm going to like you better because you had sex with a woman whom you refused to kiss? You don't understand me, do you?
We got no choice.
Meanwhile, in the real world, political movements sprung up that questioned sexual equality in Britain.
If you're doing a man's job, surely you're entitled to the same payment.
These included Women's Lib and the Gay Liberation Front, who were about to receive a rather unexpected boost.
I was a staff writer for Melody Maker. I rang up Bowie's management and asked if I could interview him. So we were having this conversation, and at some point I felt impelled to ask him. I said, are you gay? And he said, yes. He said, I have been ever since I was David Jones, which is his real name.
I didn't feel anything about it. This is a working rock and roll band. We're trying to get publicity. We're trying to sell albums. Getting a front page interview in the NME sells albums. What do you think I was looking at? I think I was really concerned. I didn't even read the bloody thing. I went, good. 3 pages. You did well.
Somebody who lived in a world who was a man but who dressed in sort of white makeup and glittering clothes and looked kind of effeminately androgynous, who had a wife that looked femininely sort of androgynous. You know, it was like they wanted to be each other.
I am.
What's it like with all these girls loving your husband so much?
Absolutely fabulous. Wouldn't you love to be loved by so many?
You kind of imagine them having this life with kind of, you know, they could have sex with men or women or both of them all together or lots of them all together. And it was sort of fascinating, you know. I remember the first time when you watched Starman on Top of the Pops and he put his arm around the guitarist, Mick Ronson. Now, that was a defining moment in pop. You know, the lead singer, dressed as he was dressed, you know, put his arm flirtatiously and protectively around the lead guitarist, and it spoke of something else. You used to hear things about Mark Bolan was sleeping with the bongo player, Mickey Finn, you know, all these kind of stories that would go around, and it was all part of the kind of sort of fantasticness of it all.
Was a bit too edgy for the young girls market in a way. He was a bit sophisticated, I think, really, and a bit complex. Pop stars that young girls absolutely adored, you know, were not the sort of archetypal rock stars. It wasn't anybody who looked remotely sexually threatening. It was kind of girly looking boys. It was non-threatening types, cute, you know, really almost androgynous looking. So therefore you had the sort of Donny Osmond, David Cassidy, Mark Bolan, very pretty, you know, cute.
A new golden age of pop dawned on Britain, and teenage girls simply lost the plot. The last pop sensation we had sent to America was the Beatles, and now they were paying us back in full. Artists like David Cassidy and the Osmonds commanded rapturous airport welcomes.
We love you!
Not to be outdone, we had our own pop crumpet in the form of blue-eyed boy David Essex.
Oh, is he more, too much more than a pretty face?
Hey, on the roses!
And the Bay City Rollers proved that the all-boy group formula that had worked so well in the previous decade could still send them weak at the knees.
They came up with that whole Tartan Army thing, you know, the whole fashion. Fashion was more important than the other music, you know. Sing Shang-a-Lang and wear your trousers really high with tartan around the bottom and tartan on the top of your denim jacket and scarves hanging off, you know, really cheap, simple things.
To succeed in a competitive pop market, you had to keep one step ahead. And for his next bombshell, David Bowie decided to play his shows not as himself, but as Ziggy Stardust. A character part rock star, part extraterrestrial. He renamed the band The Spiders from Mars, and a generation of fans bought into the fantasy.
Now Ziggy play guitar, jamming good with weird.
The Ziggy Stardust show, old mentor.
Remember her high up and looking down, seeing David making this wonderful entrance in Ziggy Stardust with obviously my trademark of dry ice and glitter and this flaming red hair and that wonderful, wonderful song.
He walked into my flat as Ziggy. We were going out for that night, you know, him and Angie and me and my ex-wife, and he walks in the kitchen dressed like that. And my babysitter dropped the baby's formula on the floor and it crashed to the floor when she saw him, and he was quite a startling image. But out of his body came the voice of my old mate, David Bowie.
Ziggy was not a mask for David. On the contrary, it was the removal of the mask. It was himself, maybe, as he desired to be or dreamt of being or was somewhere lurking, not too deeply under his skin.
He was an ass with God-given ass.
I mean, if I'd been at all responsible for people finding more characters in themselves than they originally thought they had, then I'm pleased, because that's something I feel very strongly about, that one isn't totally what one has been conditioned to think one is.
There are certain moments in everyone's life where bits of music just throw open a door to a room of music that you didn't know existed. Huge, huge bits of music that created pictures in your head. Long before videos were invented, that's what music used to do. You know, I'd be driving back from Inverness to Glasgow, which in those days took 5.5 hours, freezing cold, and I'd have my 8-track cartridge player blasting out, you know, Moon Age Daydream, and it just, these images were going on in my head like you wouldn't believe.
It's such a holy place to be. Make me, baby. Make me know you really care. Make me jump into the air.
General rock and roll cliché is a very narrow worldview. It's very restrictive and, by definition, not very dangerous. What we were interested in and what our heroes did was far more dangerous, because they got into the suburbs, you know. That was the great thing about a Roxy Music single, you know, Brian Eno being on television. You've really got some effect if you get onto television screens with a slightly subversive idea that's commercial at the same time.
Hitchhiked away across the USA, plucked her eyebrows on the way, shaved her legs, and then he was a she, says.
Bowie's next move was to produce an album for another 60s mentor, Lou Reed. Transformer was a celebration of sexual ambiguity and boho decadence. From out on it spawned a British top 10 hit with Walk on the Wild Side, a hymn in praise of transvestites. But she never lost. Photographer Mick Rock shot the iconic album cover.
She says, "Hey babe, take a walk on the wild side."
Dave once tried to say that they weren't there. He was trying to whisper something into Lou's ear, but nobody whispers when they're both puckering up at the same time. So take it from me, there was a big wet kiss went on that night. And why not? Two great artists who did love each other. Why shouldn't they give each other a nice little kiss?
Caught with a flat world. How about that? Well, babies, don't you panic. By the light of the night.
By the mid 70s, the gender exploration that glam rock had fostered had spread into the wider arena of pop culture. You could even take your mum to see a rock musical about straight men dressing as men.
Everybody's ideas were shifting about what it was to be a human being. The polarized male-female situation of being human was blending. Unisex was a term at the time. You still see it occasionally. I think, how old? Fashioned. Unisex hairdressers, you go, how old fashioned would that be, that's saying. Rose to mother, could you save from a troubling
pain? It was great fun to go at 11 o'clock to the classic cinema where you could sit and be uproarious. And I went, I think, several times, and I actually even went with, I think at the time, a couple of the members of the Sex Pistols before they became the Sex Pistols. And we'd hang in there. It was 11 o'clock and you saw all these guys, some girls, semi-naked and talking about sexuality and dirty sex.
And to further confuse the issue, there now emerged a band called Queen, who mixed all up. They served up hard rock with a side order of vaudeville and added a little rock opera to wash it all down.
It's always been an incredible gay influence, and during the early 70s it became more overt, but the people that were actually representing it were people that were straight. Do you say like Jagger, you know, this ambiguous sexuality and effeminate presentation was done by men at that time, and Bolan was certainly not gay.
It's not just a bunch of fellas wandering around looking like big puffs. I remember David pointing out that Elvis one dyed his hair and had worn eye makeup from the beginning. So it was an intrinsic part of rock and roll, at least a certain very important element in rock and roll. In fact, most of the sex going on that scene was heterosexual sex. There was quite a fair dollop of the other kind, but most of it was heterosexual sex. If you wanted to get the really hip girls, you better look like one of them.
Everybody wanted in on glam. Even the kings of the 60s realized that camping it up was now the only game in town. Rod the Mod came back as genetically modified Rod. And Roy Wood came back as, well, God knows what. Glam quickly became another lumpin' fad that anybody could jump on.
And sometimes the ugliest people in the world, I mean, like a band like Sweet, and God rock them, even with makeup, you know, they looked horrendous. Noddy Holder, you know, was so down-to-earth broomy. And there was nothing remotely sort of pretty about any of them. And I mean, Gary Glitter was dressed up from head to toe in sort of silver. He looked like an oven-ready turkey, I mean, you know, and huge platform boots. And he was hugely fat.
Glam rock was glam rock, okay? You had men dressing up in women's clothes, basically, and with all the makeup on, and it was a whole thing, you know? I was the opposite.
Yet the glam gravy train was to produce the most unlikely first in the form of leather-wearing, bass-toting Susie Quattro.
Women did not have a voice in rock and roll. They had a voice as singers. They didn't have a voice as musicians. Fans and other artists have told me, I showed a different way that women could be. I opened up the door for women to be seen as having balls.
Susie Quattro's success was initially a phenomenon, but one with a legacy. In an interview with Susie in 1974, a fledgling NME journalist wrote jubilantly, "Goodbye, tits and ass. Hello, rock and roll." Her name was Chrissy Hind.
Revolution was beginning, and it was a gender revolution, and it was when people could question how they felt inside. And for me, the big issue was that inside I did not feel anything that I was being educated to be, and that was to be a nice little woman who had three kids, shut up, cleaned the house, and perhaps had a part-time job. None of that appealed to me.
I think that's what glam rock did, that they created characters that were different from how people perceived them off of the stage. And I unashamedly nicked that idea by, you know, and took it into prog rock, which completely freaked everybody out by walking on in sparkly capes, which I still do. Where prog rock differed was because it was mostly guys who certainly none of us would have won any beauty contests. Really not going to attract any women to go, oh, I fancy him or I fancy him.
I just thought it was all very nice and safe. You know, that everyone was doing very nicely. They all had their country mentions or whatever, but I think their music reflected that. I think it reflected that they were pipe and slippers.
Prog was progressive rock. It had developed out of the British blues rock explosion at the end of the 60s and had forgotten the one element that the blues was all about: sex.
And that's why it was great for people like me, because whether it stems back from my prudish upbringing or whatever, you know, to write songs about people having sex wasn't really my scene, but I could happily write about King Arthur or Six Wives of Henry VIII.
Yes, and Genesis and all these ridiculous ELP and all these stupid overblown bands with sort of 25 articulated lorries full of like sort of ridiculous equipment. I mean, songs about pixies and wizards, you know. ...20-minute guitar solos, boring everyone to death. And then, and after the guitar solo finish, you get like a 15-minute drum solo. Bloody hell, what was that all about?
There were so many tribes at that time. There was never the one movement. There were the skinheads, and there were the guys who liked Bowie, and there were the guys who liked Rod Stewart faces, and then there were the middle class kids who were buying Dark Side of the Moon, and they'd all have their little places to converge, little shops. There'd be one shop that sold certain things, and you had to get to that shop, and that was a meeting point for everybody. So that made the adventure even greater.
The King's Road was a magnet for the tribes of London, the place where fashion and music collided. In the mid-70s, it would be the crucible from which a whole new scene and sound would emerge. Malcolm McLaren, like his hero Larry Parnes, wasn't in the music business when the management bug hit him. Instead, he ran a clothes shop selling outrageous gear.
And this store started to be invaded by kids who were following in some way in the footsteps of people like David Bowie, followed by young kids looking for something new.
I've always been very drawn to the 20s and 30s. I loved Mae West, you know, I loved her lines, and but I was definitely more attracted to the dark, Louise Brooks as well, and Bette Davis, like finding out more about how feisty they were and would give the studio system hell and break the rules, basically, of the time.
The one thing we thought was so provocative in terms of clothing at the time was sexual clothes. You can imagine mothers with hands over their eyes like this, dragging their son or daughter in, who were poking at rubber knickers and whips and chains in what was the center, supposedly, of boutique, pop cultural lifestyle and clothes. Suddenly it would need the provision of a musical sound to go with this look.
McLaren took his first steps in pop management with the New York Dolls, whom he took over briefly in 1974. While in New York, he stumbled across punk, a new sound being pioneered by artists like the Ramones and Patti Smith. Realizing that punk might play better in a bored England, McLaren returned home to assemble a band from the kids that hung around his shop.
We wanted them to be these kind of young, sexy assassins, and we called them the Sex Pistols.
And what sort of people were kinds of seeing at the beginning?
I don't know, just bored people. Bored out their brains with hippies.
What's this thing you got against hippies?
They're complacent.
The Sex Pistols were a secret weapon ready to be unleashed on a country in a stupor. A weak economy meant high unemployment, energy crises, and rubbish strikes, and made 70s Britain feel miserable.
People go on about the unemployment in the mid-70s, but it was also this terrible attitude. Britain was very backwards, and it needed to kick up the backside. You cannot get the message through to people how bad and dire the music scene was in 1975.
Even the dogs couldn't stand Gilbert O'Sullivan and Pan's People anymore. In a country where there was little to do, television was the main outlet for getting the latest pop fashions. In 1976, Queen were due to appear at the Today Show, but cancelled at the last minute. No problem, announced the host, Bill Grundy. They had the latest London pop sensation instead.
Punk rockers. The new craze, they tell me. I am an
anarchist. Dirty fucker. Shit. I guess
I always wanted to meet you.
Always wanted to meet you, Bill.
We'll be up with you, shall
we? Dirty son.
After the show happened, the phones were in the green room, so they were all ringing up. Me and Steve were just picking up the phone because people complained about the language on the program. We said, fuck off.
When the Pistols went on the Bill Grundy show, there was the hierarchy and bowler hats and everything else. It was disgraceful and everything else. And as a kid, you thought, that's pretty cool, really.
Teenagers relate to punk, and it spread like wildfire. The subverted sexual image that punk presented meant that for the first time, pop music was not serving up idealized images of sex and glam. Instead, teenage audiences were being offered a gritty, darker reality.
The popularity of punk rock was, in effect, due to the fact that it made ugliness beautiful. The nihilism, the color black, the torn qualities led to a DIY look, all led to an anti-design, anti-fashion, anti-social, anti-establishment, a we-hate-everything vibe that
became immensely and immeasurably attractive.
We're a punk band, and this is Cork Can't Be Happy Tonight.
I did the punk thing because I wanted to play, and I wanted to play something that was better than the crap that was on the radio and TV at the time, you know? And that it was unbelievable to me, you know, that I got free beer, they paid me, and birds found me attractive. It's fantastic.
There was immediately an enemy who hated it. The whole generation really despised punk because it wasn't musically clever.
I was never a Sex Pistols fan, to be brutally honest. I hated it.
It was so hard to listen to.
I just didn't like punk.
Sickly, bad-tempered little people who spit on the audience.
No future? Punk reinvigorated record sales. Pistols happily signed three lucrative record contracts, and the Clash were paid £100,000 advance. The two bands dominated the punk scene in 1977, yet they looked like they'd just jumped out of the audience.
Because DIY was really integral to punk's DNA, anybody could have a bash, and that included women. You never really saw that many females on stage making music until punk.
Susie and the Banshees.
What did you sing?
The Lord's Prayer via Twist and Shout, Knocking on Heaven's Door, and a bit of Deutschland, Deutschland, Uber Alley.
Are you a singer?
Yeah.
Had you sung before?
Not on stage, no.
It's the first time that women were allowed to have any kind of power and any kind of assertiveness, and have a threat, have an open threat about them.
You just didn't take advantage of Susie. Punk allowed women to be aggressive. It allowed women to say, well, actually, yeah, I have got tits and I have got a fanny, but that doesn't mean you're invited to touch it. It doesn't mean that you have any access to it whatsoever. Actually, thanks. Fuck off.
Women broke the mold of male fantasy.